Every year, usually during our graduation ceremonies, UBC has the honor of bestowing honorary degrees upon individuals who, in the opinion of the university community, have fit the criteria of excellence and eminence in their chosen field. Tista Settelvad exemplifies these characteristics, and it is our pleasure to grant her an honorary degree. Tista Settelvad is an Indian civil rights activist and author who has made extraordinary contributions in support of marginalized populations plagued by communal violence. After graduating from Bombay University in 1983, she began a career as a reporter for the Mumbai editions of the Daily and the Indian Express newspapers. Her first brush with communal violence came when she covered the 1984 Hindu-Muslim riots that shook the region around the city of Bhiwandi in the state of Maharashtra, the state's worst communal outbreak since partition. Approximately 10 years after embarking upon an award-winning career in journalism, she left the profession to sharpen her focus on civil rights activism, working to expose majoritarianism and religious fanaticism both in India and in other parts of the world. She has also been influential on issues related to the rights of women, religious minorities, indigenous persons, and the LGBTQ community. Her work in education pioneered KHOJ, a unique program for a plural India program. She's perhaps best known, however, for playing a prominent role in the campaign for justice for the victims of the 2002 massacre of thousands of Muslims in the state of Gujarat. As a co-founder and secretary of the influential non-governmental organization, Citizens for Justice and Peace, she played a key role to facilitate representation and assistance for those impacted by the National Citizens Register, which rendered almost 2 million people as non-citizens in the state of Assam. Her work has enriched Indian human rights jurisprudence, especially victimology within Indian courts. Not surprisingly, she has been the recipient of numerous awards and citations, including the 2003 Nuremberg International Human Rights Award. In recognition of her leadership and influence in the protection of civil and human rights, we are pleased to confer the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa, upon Tista Atul Settelvad. It now gives me great pleasure to ask Dr. Settelvad to say a few words.
Mr. Chancellor, Mr. President, and members of the UBC community, this is indeed a rare, unusual, and precious occasion. Rare and unusual because of the creative ways in which we are together, remotely online, given what all the challenges our societies and peoples face in the wake of the crippling coronavirus pandemic. Now more than ever, the impact has been worse on our most marginalized and unseen populations, who are also among those who contribute most fundamentally to run our urban and rural economies. Precious, because even in these solitary and rather bleak times, there comes such a moment where I, among others, am one of those fortunate enough to indulge in a moment of celebration, recognition, and vindication of the work put in for the realization of legal and civil rights in defense of diversity and non-discrimination for decades. It is a humbling and rewarding moment. To all the other recipients of the honorary doctorate degrees, I offer salutes. Esteemed friends, world over, we are seeing a brutal assault on fundamental freedoms and dignity, where ironically, it is the state and governments that lead the charge. Sadness, dread, tears, and anger are what my fellow compatriots in the human rights and media fraternity feel within my country, and what I wake up to each day. As the rule of law, premised on a constitutional philosophy of due process, adherence to both transparency and accountability is trampled. For decades now, our involvement in and my obsession, if you like, with has involved working with the application of the law for the realization of social justice, inclusion, and compassion. In this journey that often and inevitably leads to a conflict with entrenched interests within and outside government, what is stark is the refusal of existing agencies to apply legal standards to interrogate available evidence, apply laws to question perpetrators in positions of power during the occurrence of mass targeted crimes. Our job then, as lawyers and activists, is to stay the course, persevere, not abandon the survivor in her pursuit for justice, and often, therefore, face the malice of an unforgiving system. To push the envelope in the pursuit of justice remains the real challenge. The long arm of the law is often twisted by vindictive regimes, and substantive justice is often delayed or completely denied. Friends, today in my country, as in so many across the world, which include Turkey, Hungary, Pakistan, among many others, state power is being abused at every and all levels to stifle voices of social and political dissent. Jail terms under draconian anti-terror federal and state laws have denied lawyers, thinkers, activists, and working citizens their freedoms. This abuse continues even as we meet and I speak. The northern region of Kashmir is a particular target, and the media there functions under serious threat. Vendetta and revenge appears to be the guiding principles of regimes. Promptness and vigilance from the institutions created to check such fundamental abuses are tardy and wanting. The challenge for us today is to renew the faith, the pledge to ourselves, the Constitution of India and the world, that we will not be silenced by this relentless assault. There are laws and there are laws. Laws that can undermine universal and sublime principles of equality, dignity, diversity, and non-discrimination, emancipatory laws, and those that can institutionalize inequality, indignity, homogeneity, and discrimination. Societies such as ours, which are still layered by privilege and structural difference, resist the implementation of the former, especially if they've been passed to ensure the recognition of rights of those rendered voiceless, women, indigenous peoples, Adivasis, religious minorities, Dalits, working Indians. In past centuries, before the world evolved the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and countries transformed into more inclusive and equitous frameworks, the term black laws to label those which denied and discriminated was common. Today, we know and understand that it is extremely racist to use such a term. Ironic, is it not, that in the 21st century world and in India, our being the world's largest democracy, a string of such anti-inclusion and anti-empowerment laws are being passed by legislatures that have one thing in common, a brute electoral majority. Electoral victories and majorities clearly do not deepen constitutional rights-driven morality. They often vitiate it. Not only are these developments a challenge to the student of law, philosophy, and political science, but they ought to raise a serious reckoning to all those concerned with taking or leading our societies towards a more humane and just order. One of the most fundamental assaults in my country, likely to cause a civil death to millions of Indians, has been through amendments in citizenship laws and threatened documentary tests of citizenship. Already in the northeastern state of Assam, a staggering 2.2 million Indians and their families face the specter of statelessness. It is in this world of inverted order and disordered logic that another phenomenon challenges humane existence: the persistence, spread, and legitimization of hate speech. Hate speech is not free speech in that it almost always targets already vulnerable populations situated in structural, social, or political inequality. Weaponizing the nation state and weaponizing religion go hand in hand when sedition, blasphemy, and apostasy laws are used to block critical questioning and expression. Hate speech anywhere and everywhere is proliferating, and the vicious spoken and written word is often the precursor to the physical targeting of vulnerable populations and minorities. The UBC academic community is a fit place to share these concerns with. a daunting challenge is to set right this inversion and put our societies and governments back on the road to both truth and justice. Thank you all.